The ancient Assyrians used them, so did the Egyptians. For millennia, rasps and other tools have helped sculptors create powerful works of art. A few years ago, the family of Gaston Lachaise, one of America's acclaimed 20th century sculptors, invited the Lachaise Foundation to come and take the artist's toolbox. Inside were modeling tools, edge tools, wood and marble carving tools, mallets and bush hammers, spatulas and trowels, an old wooden spoon plus a honing stone and safety goggles. Some tools bear the imprint of known manufacturers: a Buck Brothers Massachusetts chisel, a Herring Brothers London Riffler rasp, a tiny hook marked Gesswein, New York. It is possible that Lachaise and Paul Gesswein crossed paths traveling between New York and Boston. Lachaise would then continue north to Maine, spending as much time as he could with his beloved Isabel, wherever she was. The American, of French-Canadian descent, whom he had met in Paris, followed to America, and married in 1917. Isabel was, and would always be, the primary inspiration for his work. How did Lachaise acquire these tools? With a small income and large demands, he might have frequented pawn shops or traded with other sculptors. One tool may have come from his time working with René Lalique in Paris, another from his Boston years helping Henry Hudson Kitson, or his years with Paul Manship in New York working on the AT&T building, or on the panels for the home of its architect, Wells Bosworth, in Locust Valley. Lachaise burned the candle at both ends, working long hours for his employer, and then on his own projects late into the night, modeling the forms of his muse, model, and wife, Isabel. In 1924, Lachaise found a studio and living space at 20 West 8th Street. It was here that Lachaise carved the bust of James Sibley Watson, editor of the avant-garde Dial magazine, as well as beginning the busts of the gallerist Alfred Stieglitz and his wife, Georgia O'Keeffe, to celebrate their wedding. Stieglitz recalled sitting for Lachaise in his studio on 8th Street, Lachaise working with terrific intensity, and a man knocking on the door and handing Lachaise an eviction notice. From about 1927 to 33, Lachaise's studio was at 55 West 8th Street. Evelyn Gerstein Garfield, a movie critic who reminded Lachaise of Greta Garbo, described his studio: a great bare room on the top floor of a building on 8th Street. Any hour of the day or night, you will find him there, sleeves rolled up, his dungarees heavy with dust, the place suffused with the chill odor of marble and granite dust. His gleaming and supple woman in bronze presides like some sad primeval goddess. The painter Henry Strader, with whom Lachaise shared his studio for a time, attested that Lachaise finished his castings with burnishing and filing. Sculptor Robert Laurent shared that in about 1930, Lachaise had begun to use an automatic chisel. He was pleased at the speed with which he could rough out large areas. Lachaise finished these stone reliefs at Rockefeller Center by hand. In 2016, we showed the tools to Bob Spring of the Modern Art Foundry. For three generations since its founding in 1932, the foundry has cast the work of Lachaise. Lachaise may have met John Spring, Bob's father, in the wax department of Roman Bronze Works or at the American Art Foundry. Today, the foundation is fortunate to work with Jeffrey Spring and his sister Mary Jo Bursig and many talented craftsmen. Here's Bob.
You know, these should be in a museum.
Enter Andrew Eschelbacher, at the time a curator at the Portland Museum of Art and organizing a new American sculpture, Lachaise, Laurent, Nadelman, and Zorak. In addition, he planned an installation around the corner called Tools and Techniques, Sculptures, Materials, and Multiples.
So we'll have bronzes, marbles, direct carvings on one side of the room, and on the opposite side of the room, we want to install these tools. We want to use these tools to help people understand how sculpture is made.
And so, from 2017 until 2020, just miles from Lachaise's home and studio in Georgetown, Maine, where he made so many of his works, the Portland Museum installed a selection of the artist's tools laid out along the wall and inside a case for close viewing. An interactive multimedia kiosk has audio by Harvard Art Museum's Tony Sigel explicating some of the tools, as well as the process of making multiples. Pivot, and you can peruse for yourself the surfaces and tool marks Tony references on the plaster model of Torso of Elevation, on loan from the Lachaise Foundation, along with the tools. Here follows a selection from Tony's commentary.
The wood tool is what I usually call an oval tip tool. It's very useful for smoothing and making rounded contours in clay. A second tool can be used in clay, but it's mainly used in plaster. Sometimes it's useful to have a rough texture in plaster, and you can see there are serrations in the edges of it It's really a general purpose plaster modeling tool used to scoop up plaster and apply it to a surface or trim edges of a mold. We know that Lachaise modeled his full figure sculpture in clay originally, and from that clay original, a mold was made around it and plaster was poured into the mold. The artist would have smoothed the clay and removed many of the tool marks. And in the plaster, about the only place where you can still see marks from the clay tools are in the cut-off arms and the top of the neck. What we're seeing in this image is the marks from the clay tools on the right-hand side on the back of the arm. And on the front, the very finer, sharper tools used to shape the plaster. And we can see they'd be very different kinds of marks. Sculptors would have used knives, from a pocket knife to a big kitchen carving knife, for many different purposes in their studio. But in this case, we see the knife being used in a very specific way during the casting and mold-making process. The first stage of making such a mold would be to cover it with gelatin, probably to a depth of about an eighth to a quarter of an inch. And being flexible, it would record all the finest details of the surface. But the gelatin then had to be removed from the torso somehow. And for this purpose, a knife was used. The knife marks show that the knife is drawn through the gelatin mold and into the plaster along those lines, and that those are the sections of the mold that was lifted off of the model. A rasp is a small steel tool that has teeth, which are very abrasive and can be used in numerous different ways. You can use it flat across the surface, you could turn it up on its edge and almost use it like a saw, and any angle in between. And its pointed little teeth leave tiny little lines in the surface of whatever it's used on. A sculptor like Lachaise had a dozen or more rasps of this kind, with larger and smaller teeth, from a small butter knife size to a foot and a half long. On the right hip, a very large rasp was used to substantially reshape that whole area, from about the waist down to where the thigh begins. Clearly, when the plaster model was removed from the mold, the artist saw his composition in a new material. Plaster is pretty white when it comes out of the mold, as opposed to the clay, which would have been pretty dark. And sometimes a shift in the medium will cause an artist to see things and shapes and volumes in a different way. What's a little unusual about this area is that the artist simply left that right hip rather rough with the rasp marks intact. Typically, the progression would be you use the larger rasp to reshape, the finer rasp to smooth out the marks from the larger rasp, and then follow it up with something like sandpaper to achieve a very smooth surface. The kinds of tooth tools that we found in Lachaise's toolbox are really marble sculpting tools. It's an intermediate marble carving tool. The first marble carving tool is like a big single sharp spike that's hammered into the marble and breaks off larger chunks of it. But then you want to use something called a tooth tool. And this makes not a smooth, but a smoother surface. The ridges that the tool makes look like a corduroy fabric that makes it easier to see the surface you're working on. Many sculptors used tooth tools to model clay and even plaster. We can be pretty sure that Lachaise used a tooth tool in the clay modeling stage. Unfortunately, then he smoothed it with other tools, so we don't see any of the marks from that tool left. But where we do see it is in the base, because when Lachaise decided to make a torso out of his full figured sculpture, he needed to have some kind of a base so it would stand up on its own. So he made a base out of more plaster that he piled on and shaped around the cutoff legs. And he used a trowel to layer on the plaster and tooth tool to do some of the shaping. And we can see traces of that tooth tool captured in the plaster of the base. These are wire loop tools, and they're used to reach into areas where a sculptor might want to remove clay. For example, to create the deep recesses where limbs are pressed up against the body, or they can be dragged along the surface of the clay to smooth out bumps and lumps from the use of other tools. These tools are actually very high-quality handmade tools. You can see that the wire itself is different thicknesses in different places. Where it emerges from the handle, it's fairly thick, but when it wraps around into that rounded triangular shape, the wire has been hand-filed into a thin, almost knife-like profile. It cuts into the clay more readily and easily. The smallest wire loop tool was forged out of a single steel bar. A hole in the bar was opened up on each end and shaped into this beautiful, delicate triangle of steel. Files are smoothing tools made out of steel that have teeth cut across them in lines. One of the files has a curved over tip almost into a hook-like shape. And if you look at it very closely, even with magnifying glass, you would see that there are tiny teeth that spiral around the end of the curved tip. Such tiny files with curved ends were used to smooth deep and inaccessible areas, for example, the space between someone's fingers or toes. Some artists wanted the traces of their work to be very visible, and so they very carefully preserved these tool marks and working marks. Other artists, and I think you could include Lachaise, wanted the remnants of their process filed away, sanded away, and polished away, so that by the time it reached the final bronze, it had a perfectly smooth, even surface. The reason we see that he's left lots of tool marks here in the plaster is probably because this plaster torso had a mold made around it, and from that mold, wax versions were made. The wax is easy to smooth using heat, polishing with cloths, and smoothing with wooden tools.
Lachaise admired his many predecessors, as well as the masters of his day, including Rodin, Epstein, Lembroek, and Brancusi. Sublimation and amplification. This was Lachaise's stated artistic principle. You can see that in Torso of Elevation, taken as a freestanding fragment from his life-size figure Standing Woman Elevation. While documents from Lachaise himself, Isabel, and Lachaise's biographers Donald Goodall and Gerald Nordland suggest that Elevation was probably completed in 1917 in time for his exhibition at Bourgeois Gallery, it was not cast in bronze until 1927. Lachaise wrote to Schofield Thayer in 1924, "I am myself quite anxious to see it in its final material, completed by the work I intend to do in the bronze." Lachaise included both the bronze, which he dated 1912 to 27, and the plaster torso, which he dated 1934, in his Museum of Modern Art retrospective of 1935. Tragically, Lachaise died just months after the retrospective of acute leukemia. "A tawdry, ineffective funeral," wrote Henry McBride in the New York Sun. "That's the way we buried Melville. That's the way we buried Poe. Greatness would not be greatness if it could be understood generally." Lachaise left behind a lifetime of work in gardens, on public buildings, cemeteries, hoods of cars, in living rooms, and storerooms, established in 1963 to protect, promote, and perpetuate the legacy of Gaston Lachaise for the public benefit. The Lachaise Foundation cares for his original plaster models, overseeing strictly limited editions of his work in bronze to sell, lend, and gift to various institutions around the world. This torso was reproduced from the original plaster model to make a total of 9 bronze sculptures, each representing the goddess Lachaise sought to express in all his work.